Mr. Chapman.
It's me.
Yeah, or should I call you Michael?
Michael's good.
Welcome, good to have you.
And lovely to be, it's lovely to be back in Utrecht again.
Yeah? You've been here before?
First time was 68.
68?
Yep.
Wow. That sounds pretty much like the year your guitar could be from.
Well, this is actually a 64.
Yeah, it sounds so... It has such a vintage sound.
Well, they're not like athletes. They don't burn out at 30.
Do you love the old guitar?
Yeah, I only really play old guitars.
Yeah. How long have you had this one?
I've had this about 20 years. Bought it down in, you know, just north of Macon, Georgia, in a funny little old shop in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Were you hunting for guitars?
Not really. I was just driving around the South, just soaking up the atmosphere, and for some reason I didn't take a guitar, which is most unlike me. I've always got a guitar. And then I thought, oh... And my wife found a cake shop, and I found a guitar shop, so that's a deal.
And was it a special shop?
The cake shop?
No, the guitar shop, of course. For
yeah,
you to
it,
find
it was.
This guitar.
Yeah, there was such a... Everyone was Bobby... There was Bobby Lee and Bobby Riley. They were good old boys, dungarees. And they had an old-fashioned barber's chair. And they sit in the chair and they bring you these wonderful guitars to play.
Wow. And so while you're in the barber chair...
Yeah, they brought this and I just couldn't leave without it.
Oh.
And every time I go back into that shop, they say, Michael, you stole that goddamn guitar. Because I only paid $350 for it.
Wow, okay.
That's really, what they asked me.
Really attached to it.
I love it. Love it to death, yeah.
You always bring your guitar everywhere.
I've always got a guitar, yeah.
Is that being a real singer-songwriter or people refer to you as a blues singer or folk singer or country? What kind of a singer are you to you?
Well basically, I'm not, because I can't sing. I don't even pretend, you know.
So what are you good at, according to yourself?
I'm a guitar player that writes a lot of songs, and I'm a songwriter that plays a lot of guitar. I think that does it. I hate being called a folk singer. I really hate it.
Okay, I won't do that. I won't do that.
Thank you.
The song you just performed for us, Sometimes You Live, Sometimes You Just Drive.
Yeah.
Beautiful lyrics. I was wondering, when you write as much as you do, for as long as you do, how many songs did you write?
Well, there's over 300.
300. And if you have to say, like, the balance between some songs being autobiographic or fiction, what would you...
99% of them are autobiographical. I can go through my list of songs and I'll tell you where I wrote it, what I was doing, what it's about, what was happening. That one is, that's kind of, every now and again I write an apocalyptic song, and that's one of them. There's about 8 or 10 of them.
Wow.
And I don't know why, because I'm not an apocalyptic person. You
know? Well, maybe subconsciously you are.
Yeah, maybe. Oh. How do I know? I'm not analytical at all. It's just something I do.
You just write.
Yeah, exactly.
It's
what
you do.
Yeah, the songs are kind of my diary.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
Now, you've been on the road for like 50 years.
Yeah.
Since
66.
Crazy
thing to do.
Crazy thing to do. You've written so many songs. Your voice ages over the time, of course.
Yeah.
How about the writing? The stuff you write about, the things you think about.
Well, I mean, I'm so pleased at the moment because I went for 6 years without writing a song. I had a complete block. And I just got out of it last year.
Really?
Yeah. 6 years is a long time not to write.
What did you do in that period?
Drank.
You drank, okay. All right, okay. You came out sober.
Yeah, ish.
Sober-ish, and wrote new songs.
I went to America to record an album in America, and I wrote 3 new songs for that album, and I was so pleased, because it'd been such a long time.
Yeah.
And I'm going back again in a while to do another American album. And I've got more songs than I need, which I've never had before.
Really?
Yeah.
I want to know more about that American fascination. But about the writing, did it change even after the writer's block? Like, is it harder because you understand more about life, or is it easier because you've seen so much? Yeah, or is it the same as 50 years ago?
I've never really thought about it. Like I said, I'm not analytical. It's something I just do. It's like I never practice guitar playing. It's just something I do.
Hmm.
You know, by the time I was 17, I could really play.
Hmm.
And I couldn't tell you why, because I just wanted to play, so I figured out how to play it.
Hmm.
Because there was nobody to teach me in those days. So I play it all wrong, but it's my way. You know.
Yeah, the best way.
Hopefully.
Yeah, of course. You mentioned it, Americana.
Yeah.
You have a thing for that.
Oh yeah, but I mean,
what's the thing? What's the love and the passion?
Well, I mean, when I was a kid, I used to go to the movie house every Saturday morning and watch cowboy and Indian films. And they just stuck, you know, everybody.
The music or the lyrics or the
vibe?
Well,
the landscape and the way they dressed. I mean, I always did say, Michael.
You're half a cowboy yourself.
Yeah. I'm halfway between a cowboy and a pile of laundry.
Oh my God. All right. And when did you start connecting to this kind of music, like putting it into your own style? Or
I used to visit my grandmother, who was deaf, and I used to mess about with her radio, and I found a station in, I think it was coming from Frankfurt, called AFN, American Forces Network, and they were playing music. There was Hank Williams, Charlie Parker, Miles Davis, early rock and roll, and that is so good, and especially if there was a guitar in it, you know, because in England we had songs like, well, how much is that doggy in the window, and I was, oh. Yeah.
What would you say is typically that sound? Could you show me something on your guitar, which?
Well, I heard blues players as well, like Lightning Hopkins, you know. Mm-hmm. Really primitive stuff, you know. And I thought, oh, that's for me. It's not complicated. That's for me.
Yeah.
And so I started off playing a lot of blues. Then I wandered into jazz, and I got into bebop, and I got into Django Reinhardt. And all that.
Wow.
People said, what kind of records do you buy? I said, all of them.
All of them.
Yeah.
Now, the last album that came out this year is called 50.
Yeah.
Some old songs, some new songs, also that Americana vibe.
Yeah.
I think the next song you're going to do is on that as well, right?
Yeah. This is a song about that great American icon, the truck stop waitress.
Ah, is that what it's about?
Yeah, she's out in the desert somewhere, living in a trailer with her kids.
Okay, and the song is called?
Just Another Story.
Just Another Story. I think in there is a beautiful sentence where you say, there's a scar
On a tree where she carved her name, there's a scar on her heart where a man did the same.
Oh, I love that. I'm going to listen to you. Just Another Story.
Yeah, because that's what it is. It's just another story.
Yeah, that's part of, I think, also your long experience that you can write a song like that.
Yeah, I'm a storyteller.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah, I'm going to listen to you. Thank you so much for being here.
It's been a pleasure.
Thank
you.
It's the Michael Chapman.
Thank you. It's not gin and tonic.
I'm sorry. Just water.